You know that the term Six Sigma also indicates a specific level of process capability. At this level, only 3.4 errors are expected in 1 million outputs. Process capability generally reflects the performance of a process to meet the requirements of an important attribute of the output. What is behind this evaluation?
Weight is an attribute of cookies, and we promise that our cookies have an average weight of 10 grams. Of course, we can't always bake exactly the same cookies. Therefore, we additionally promise to keep the limits between 7 and 13 grams. To check how good we fulfill our promise, we scaled each cookie and assigned it to one of different weight categories: 3 to 5, 5 to 7, 7 to 9 grams, and so on by drawing a bar. Stacking the bars in the corresponding weight categories results in the displayed frequency distribution in the histogram. And this sample fits well with a bell-shaped model of the normal distribution of Carl Friedrich Gauss. You can see that the average weight of cookies in this sample is 10 grams, and that the weight is scattered around the mean with a standard deviation of 3 grams. You probably know that the area of the distribution between minus 1 to plus 1 standard deviation around the mean covers about 68% of the cookies. Accidentally, in our example, the lower specification limit falls at minus 1 and the upper specification limit at plus 1 standard deviations. Thus, our actual process has a capability of 1 sigma, which is equivalent to a yield of about 68%. Mean and standard deviation and the specification limits are thus necessary to calculate the process capability. To understand the concepts of the mean and the standard deviation, it is useful to know both functions by heart. And the mean can easily be identified at the center of the symmetric normal distribution. Less known is that one standard deviation also results from the perpendicular through the inflection points of the distribution curve. The interval between the mean and this vertical line on the x-axis corresponds to one standard deviation. This allows you to quickly estimate one or more standard deviations in a histogram. You probably also remember that the area between minus 2 and plus 2 standard deviations covers about 95% of the cases, and 99.73% of our cookies fall between minus 3 and plus 3 standard deviations. If now, accidentally, the lower and upper specification limits for our cookies fall on minus 2 and plus 2 standard deviations, then our process has a capability of 2 sigma, which is equivalent to a yield of about 95%. The more outputs are between, and the fewer are outside the specification limits, the more capable the process is. The ability decreases the more cookies are outside the specification limits, and each of these outsiders has a problem. This principle is further illustrated by my simulated Six Sigma process. There is an interval width of 6 standard deviations from the mean value to the specification limits. And as you can see, there is still a lot of space from the extreme values of the distribution up to these respective specification limits. Now compare these relationships with the simulated 3 sigma process. The extreme values of this distribution are already outside the specification limits, and it can easily be evaluated that the 3 sigma process is less capable than the 6 sigma process. But why do we call this capability 3 sigma and not 3 standard deviations? If we calculate parameters for a certain sample, or plot, for example, a concrete frequency distribution, then we use Latin letters, x bar and s. Greek letters, mu and sigma, and the corresponding calculations are used in statistics if we want to infer from the concrete sample we took to the assumed population of possible outputs. This is what the customer can expect in the future, derived from the collected sample.
There are two ways to increase process capability. If we convince our customer to widen the area of tolerated outputs, i.e. shift the specification limits away from the mean, then the capability of our process rises without changing the process. It's just because we got a broader garage without improving our capability to drive the car. This proposal is not entirely serious, but may be necessary in cases where different departments subtract individual fear buffers from the specification limits originally required by the customer. Typically, you must improve the process by centering your outputs and reducing their variability, so that more outputs fall between the specification limits. In this case, you always get into a very narrow garage without dents.
Let's apply this idea to our bakery. Imagine we baked cookies on 4 days, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday. We have measured the weight and diameter of the cookies and mapped the weight on the horizontal and the diameter on the vertical axis. We have also drawn a target and promise our customer that weight and diameter will be within the second ring of the target, representing our specification limits. What differences do you notice between the results of the 4 days? The results in columns on Monday and Wednesday differ from the results on Tuesday and Thursday in the degree of their scattering. And the results in rows on Monday and Tuesday differ from the results on Wednesday and Thursday in the degree of their position centering. If we now drop the weight data on the x-axis, then again, the idealized distributions of the weight result for each of the 4 days. If we now also project the specification limits onto the weight axis, then we can already estimate the portion that falls within and outside the specification limits on the respective days. On Wednesday, for example, we achieved a result of about 1 sigma, and Thursday was our best day. Today is Friday. You are the Six Sigma expert, and all responsible process owners are sitting around you. Everyone agrees that Thursday's result should be repeated in future. Unfortunately, we lost Thursday's records of process and machine settings. But we have the records for the other 3 days. Which day offers the best starting point to achieve the good results of Thursday again? We would probably not start with Monday's settings. But what about Wednesday? We have a large spread, but we already produce about 68% suitable cookies right away. If we start with Tuesday's settings, then we only produce scrap, but we have already achieved a very small spread. If we have no idea which influences were responsible for the position shift on Tuesday or the scattering on Wednesday, then we would have to assume how shifts in scattering are typically caused. If we are lucky, then the position shift is caused by exactly one systematic influence. Once we have identified this influence, we can correct the process quickly and with little effort. Systematic influences in the process, like for example shifts, are indicated in control charts. Scattering, however, is almost always caused by an interaction of a multitude of influences. This is the basis for the normal distribution in many application areas. Think of the complex influences that, for example, determine the human body size. And it is not always easy to identify and control these influences. So if we could choose a day, we would choose Tuesday. But we cannot do that in practice. Typically, we'll have to deal with position shifts and scattering. And this is the challenging task in a Six Sigma project, centering the position and reducing the scatter. Nothing more, but nothing less. To give you an impression of the relative proportions of percentages and sigma levels, I researched the defect rates for a few everyday examples and converted them into sigma levels. However, these are not statements about process capability, as no specification limits are considered. It is only a conversion of percentage values into Z values of the standard normal distribution. And strictly speaking, this is not allowed either, because defect rates are not and cannot be normally distributed. More about this later in the measure phase. Nevertheless, I would additionally like to briefly explain the difference between short-term and long-term sigma using these examples. Each example shows what a yield of 99% would mean. I also documented from different sources what actually happens in reality. Here you can compare the actual yields in percent and the corresponding sigma values for long-term and short-term observations respectively. As you can see, a 99% yield in air traffic would probably frighten us so much that no one would fly voluntarily. In fact, however, Safety in air traffic is 99.999894%, which corresponds to a long-term sigma level of 5.19. Safety at the workplace and in hospitals is also very high, but already significantly lower. My reference example uses a typical paperback book with 300 words per page and 300 pages per book to show the standard example for short-term Six Sigma with 3.4 errors per 1 million words, i.e. one error in 3.27 books. This performance level would have to be adjusted to 4.5 sigma if the long-term performance is to be estimated. What does the differentiation between short and long-term sigma levels mean? Observations of process performance over longer time intervals show that the mean values of the samples drift about 1.5 standard deviations around the true mean value. This is intuitively understandable when you think of a short-term temperature measurement over the course of a week and compare it with a long-term measurement over a year. The longer the time interval in which data is collected, the greater the probability that also larger deviations and extreme high and low values will occur. This increases the variability of the data and reduces the sigma level. Michael Harry, the architect of Six Sigma at Motorola, introduced appropriate adjustments to the sigma levels by distinguishing between measurements over a short versus a long time interval. The assignment to long term versus short term depends on the actual drift of the measured values over time. The 3.4 ppm from the standard example of Motorola corresponds to a Z value of 4.5 in the standard normal distribution according to Carl Friedrich Gauss. Michael Harris suggests maintaining this level of 4.5 sigma if data are based on long-term measurements. However, if this data is to be compared with data from a short-term interval, then 1.5 standard deviations is added. Thus, the 3.4 ppm corresponds to 6 sigma for short-term and 4.5 sigma for long-term measurements. But we won't need this for your project. In a typical Six Sigma project, we compare short-term measurements from the measure phase before with short-term measurements from the control phase after improvements. And for both samples, we will calculate the sigma levels based on Z values according to the standard normal distribution. The Sigma Guide tool contains a calculator that allows you to make an initial assessment of the performance of your process.
What is the appropriate target sigma level for your process? The typical level at the beginning of my project is between -1 and +3 sigma. Nothing to be ashamed of. The right target level for your project, however, depends on your process and your industry. Of course, an automated process in semiconductor production can reach a higher yield than the sales process in a car dealership. On the other hand, process capability depends on the specifications of your customer and the requirements of your company. 99% yield can therefore be excellent in one process and alarming in another.